Hi, my name is Kim Clark. I'm an integration architect working for IBM. When I'm working with customers on their integration architecture, something that starts more arguments than just about anything else is this question of how are microservices related to service-oriented architecture? For example, is one an evolution of the other, or are they completely different concepts? So let's start by making sure we're all on exactly the same page around what microservices architecture really is. To be honest, it might have been better if it was named microcomponent architecture, because it's really about breaking up applications into smaller pieces, pieces that can be changed in a more agile fashion, so you can increase the velocity of development, so that you can scale them independently of one another, so that you can introduce different resilience models across different individual microcomponents. So lots of really interesting benefits from being able to break up applications into smaller pieces. So with that definition of microservices as something that's at an application scope about how we break up the components inside an application, we can look to service-oriented architecture as something that's at a very different scope. That's at a scope of the enterprise, where we're taking the opportunity to expose applications in standardized ways so that they can be reused by other applications using those interfaces across the breadth of the enterprise. So SOA at an enterprise scale and microservices at an application scale. That's a distinction we could take, but it's actually quite an oversimplified distinction. And that we go into this in a lot more depth in the article that's mentioned at the bottom. But we're also going to discuss this in this video as well. So the real challenge is that there are very different views out there on what SOA was really about. Let's take a look at how two of these very different views evolved. For large enterprises with a multitude of aging systems of record, an SOA program is likely to spend a huge amount of time and budget solving hard integration problems. How to surface those complex back-end systems of record as reusable interfaces. After a while, it may start to feel like SOA is really all about integration. However, the original aims of SOA were much broader than that. And the aim was to really re-landscape the systems of record into business services that were more applicable to the applications of the future. For perhaps a smaller company with fewer, more modern systems of record, the integration aspect of SOA might be comparatively trivial. Most of the time might be spent on that re-landscaping work, creating an intermediate level of service components that represent those valuable business services. As technology moves forward and we create more lightweight runtimes and methods for building these components, we might well create those service components as smaller independent pieces. You can see where this is going. We could call these microservice components. And now suddenly, microservices looks much more like an evolution of service-oriented architecture rather than something completely different to it. So another part of the jigsaw as to why there are wildly differing opinions around microservices and SOA is how much of your estate is actually likely to become microservices based. In a mature large enterprise such as a bank or an insurance company with IT systems created and acquired perhaps even over multiple decades, microservices architecture is just another option for how to build an application. Those microservices-based applications may or may not make use of the services already created by a previous SOA program. But SOA and microservices are occupying kind of different territory. The microservices are not going to take over the entire enterprise's IT anytime soon, any more than SOA did. It's just an alternative application architecture well suited to a particular set of solutions. Now, if we compare that to the other extreme, let's take a greenfield online startup. They might use microservices as their fundamental architectural style, and everything they build is done that way. Things they don't build, they buy as software as a service, such as Salesforce for CRM, for example, and they just connect out to it. It's not part of their IT estate. In their situation, they would describe their entire estate as microservices-orientated architecture, perhaps. Now we can see that for this company, microservices could look very much like an evolution of service-orientated architecture, and they might see it as a truly enterprise-wide architectural pattern. We should recognize that this second situation isn't limited to a small startup. It's certainly more common in more modern companies with less IT legacy. But of course, it includes very large companies such as Google, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Netflix, and so on. Up till now, you could be forgiven for thinking that microservices share many similarities with SOA, but they're just at different scopes. We need to dispel that idea. Microservices architecture introduces some principles that are pretty surprising to somebody from an SOA background. Remember, microservices is about creating small, truly independent components. So, for example, for SOA, reuse is one of the primary perceived benefits, the ability to reuse data and function from one application in another. For a microservice component, reusing a component, especially at runtime, and perhaps even at design time, results in dependencies that make the resulting solution fragile. So reuse is often discouraged. SOA typically resulted in the exposure of synchronous web services. In microservices, synchronous protocols such as HTTP, whether using SOAP or REST APIs, cause dependencies. So messaging is the preferred transport wherever possible. And it goes on, with issues relating to client-side service discovery and how data duplication occurs in event source-based applications and many more very microservice-specific patterns. For all their similarities, when it comes down to the detail, the two are very different in some fundamental ways. I promised you an argument, or at least a good way to start one. Well, the most common time I find a debate raging is when two things are being compared that don't make sense. For example, getting people to compare microservices and SOA is itself misleading. It's not clear what we're debating, and it can take a few hours to unpick that one. A microservice is a component, and SOA is, well, it's an architecture, obviously. So if we were to compare microservices architecture with service-oriented architecture, we'd have a fair comparison. We could discuss whether each of them are application architecture or enterprise architecture and so on. Another common confusion is when people start equating microservices with APIs. And in fact, that one's so common I've created a separate post on it, which you'll find a link for. If you're really in for the sport, just ask what the difference is between a microservice and a service. You get a good day or two out of that one. And by the end, you'll probably still be scrabbling for a consensus on what a service means in the first place. Of course, if you'd had a discussion about the difference between a microservice component and a service component, you'd probably have been having a more engaging and valuable discussion, and you'd probably be able to get away and build something rather than sitting in a room arguing. So it's not quite as simple as we first thought. Microservices are certainly focused on application architecture, but they may have some elements that could be taken up to the enterprise level. Whether you can do that depends on the shape and size of your enterprise. SOA is unquestionably an enterprise-level concept. You can certainly bring microservices techniques in to help you build some of the componentry out, but you have to be careful because some of the core principles between those two styles actually fight against one another. The core concepts of this were taken from the article noted at the top, so feel free to visit that to get the full story. I think I managed to get through the whole talk without ever saying Enterprise Service Bus or ESB. If you thought SOA had many interpretations, you should see the amount of different descriptions and implementations of the ESB pattern I've seen. So I wanted to keep the discussion clear of that. Almost certainly a topic for a future video though, especially given its relationship to how it's treated in the microservice community. I also drew no distinction between APIs and web services, or between APIs and SOA, but that is a critically important discussion, and there's a separate article focused on that noted at the bottom of the slide. This video is part of a series of videos and parallel posts we'll be doing in the integration blog, so feel free to keep an eye on those if you want to see more of the same.